My name is Jascha Kangisa. I recently joined the Data Warehousing Product Management, and before that, I was working in the BW development. As this session will also include some roadmap slides, as you know, we always have the disclaimer in there because that may be subject to change, as you know it from the BW roadmap slides. So in this session, we'll start with a brief overview of BW4, where we came from, starting with 1.0. Where we went at with 2.0, also how that relates to Data Warehouse Cloud, which is now also there as a new cloud offering for data warehousing, covering the public domain. And then we'll dive into the four design principles that we have or created with BW4, looking at simplicity, openness, modern UIs that we have, and what we did in terms of high performance. After that, that's probably even especially important for you guys, for the Europe-based companies. We'll have a look at how BW4 supports you in being compliant with the General Data Protection Regulation that has been set up like 2 years back, I think. So what we have added to BW4 in order to support you there. And then for all of you who are still running a classical NetWeaver-based BW, even on HANA or any other database, we'll take a look at what the conversion paths are, how we support you guys in moving from the classical BW to the new BW4 world. And then, like I said, we'll have those roadmap slides in the end, just giving you an outlook on the next years, what will be in there in terms of new features that we'll add to BW4. First, just having a brief look at the current statement of direction that we have for data warehousing with SAP. Even though especially important since we have the Data Warehouse Cloud offering, which may be confusing. So what we're basically trying to express with this slide is that Data Warehouse Cloud is not there to replace any of the already existing data warehousing solutions that we are offering. So even with Data Warehouse Cloud, there will still be a BW4, there will still be the native SQL data warehousing that's not to be replaced by Data Warehouse Cloud. But of course, based on the strategy or like the cloud strategy that you may have in your company already, or if there are any plans for like in a few years moving some data warehousing functionalities to the cloud, then of course these three products complement each other. We'll have some integrations in order to, if you want to move to the cloud, use Data Warehouse Cloud as a next tool for data warehousing. We are working on a tight integration between BW4 and Data Warehouse Cloud in order to support you to get there. But basically, like the baseline you should get from this slide is that BW4 will not be replaced. It's not a successor, but just an additional offering to also cover the public cloud domain. Briefly looking at the evolution from BW4 1.0 to 2.0. So we started in 2016, where the main point was moving or getting rid of the old AnyDB coding or functionality that we had in BW. Because by moving to HANA only, we gained many, many benefits out of that. We could leave behind all the legacy code. We could start with pushing down OLAP functionalities to the database, meaning improving the query performance. We also introduced the data tiering optimization capabilities, allowing you for a smoother handling or moving data out of BW if that is not needed anymore. In 2016, we released the first major support package, including some new DTO capabilities, having some enhanced master data loads, what you may already also know from the data store object, improving a little there. And we also started with some first tight integration with the Data Hub, especially looking into the direction of some sort of metadata integration, so that we started to integrate the metadata repository of BW into the metadata catalog of the Data Hub, plus integrating it from a process point of view, integrating the task workflows, you know, from the Data Hub into the process chains that we have in BW4 and vice versa, so that you would be able to like have an integrated process orchestration between the two. So in 2018, we released the second major feature package, SP8, containing for the first time the BW Cockpit, some Fiori, so web-based application, basically intended for the administrator persona in your company who's doing things like process chain modeling, monitoring, data load management and monitoring. So giving these kind of person also a more attractive, flexible UI. So we moved the process chain modeling in there, the monitoring over time. We also added things like external HANA view maintenance, DTO maintenance to the web-based cockpit. We also introduced new storage options for DTO. We, for the first time, added the data transfer process and transformation editor to the Eclipse tools to, over time, move all the editors to Eclipse. And then in 2019, we had the major 2.0 release, where we basically started only supporting HANA 2.0 as the database version, and we're still working on the modeling tool side. Briefly looking at the architecture, what's in there and around the BW system. Starting from the bottom to the top, as you know, you can, based on the data source capabilities that we have in BW, can connect many different kind of remote systems to your BW system to either virtually or federatedly access data from those systems or for replicating data into the system. They will make use of the HANA platform capabilities, but also have the ODP support in there. We are making use of some big data source system types as well as flat or file data source types. Looking at the developer tools on the left, we are, from an BW point of view, are mainly working with the BW modeling tools, giving the modeling persona in your company the possibility for modeling the entities that are required to build your data warehouse. Then within the application itself, it's made of the data warehousing area, the analytic manager for the basically the OLAP engine. We have the workspaces in there. And for getting data out of BW, again, there would be the open hub and ODP interface. And of course, on top, we are integrated with the analytics tools from SAP, of course, SAP Analytics Cloud, but also being open for any third-party analytics tools via SQL interfaces and MDX interfaces, plus having an integration for the BPC planning. Diving into the design principles. So we're actually talking not four design principles, but when also looking at the conversion, we are talking about five ones. So just briefly highlighting what are the main benefits of BW4 compared to the classical NetWeaver BW. So as I said it already, because we only moved or we are only supporting the HANA database now, we have the capabilities of pushing down many of the OLAP features to the database, allowing us for some performance increasements because we don't have to upload the data anymore to the application server, but can do all those calculations in the database directly. On the openness side, we already worked on possibilities for native SQL access to the data stored in BW, so looking at it from a consumption point of view, but also for getting data into BW via native SQL. We made lots of effort or put lots of effort into making BW simpler from a modeling point of view. So we drastically removed the objects or entities you would use to model the persistency, to model the virtual layer of your BW system. And the same we also did for the data integration part, looking at the data sources, where we just a little boiled down the number of source system types that we have without losing any support for remote systems you want to connect. We worked on the modern interfaces, mainly introducing the BW cockpit, plus moving all of the editors that were maybe still ZAPGUI based into the Eclipse world as well. And we are providing a conversion tool which would allow you for an easier transition from a NetWeaver BW to the BW4 world. Starting with the simplicity pattern, looking on the modeling side, like I said, so in the classical BW, we were mainly or basically using 10 different entity types that you would use to model your BW. Looking on the persistency layer, we had the info cube, we had the data store, there was the hybrid provider, the PSA table, and the info object. So that has been drastically reduced to only two. The info object is still there because we still need those master data, text, and hierarchy capabilities. But for the data persistency, there's now only the data store object left, basically combining all the features that you would have from the other object types before. And looking on the virtual layer, coming from the multi-provider, the InfoSet, composite provider, virtual provider, and transient provider. Those have been also reduced to two, mainly the composite provider and the OpenODS view for integrating remote data into BW. I'm also especially looking at the data store object. We made it a little bit more flexible in the terms of whether you want to do some bottom-up or top-down modeling. By having these what we call field-based data store objects in there already, basically allowing you to build your persistency without the need to create the required info objects first. We are trying to give you a head start in setting up your persistency. And later on, once you created all the data store objects and you then start or want to make use of the master data and text and hierarchy capabilities the info object offers, you would replace the field-based data store objects by using info objects or using within the data store objects. From looking at the how you would create your data models, especially looking at the what we call LSA++ architecture, where you previously, due to the not that improved virtual capabilities that we had, would rather build multiple levels of persistencies in your BW to build those different data mart scenarios that you may have. Because we, on the one hand, reduced the persistency object, but also made many enhancements to the virtual layer, especially in the composite provider area, the picture changed a little bit. So on the one hand, looking at the LSA architecture, you would probably try to do as much as possible on the virtual side using the composite provider. Also, because mainly of the field-based approach that we have for the data store object, we are trying to support the top-down and bottom-up modeling even more. Another aspect to the simplicity is the data tiering optimization support that we integrated into BW4 for the first time, basically giving you that consistent approach for managing the hot, warm, and cold data that you have in your persistency, in your data store objects, so that you can, from within the BW product, take care of moving the data that is not needed anymore that frequently out of the hot store to either the warm or the cold store, also allowing you to be more sufficient on the cost saving side because you don't need actually all the data in the hot store, but can make use of less expensive but therefore slower tiers in case you don't require the data anymore. We also build in support for the cold storage based on Zapana Vora. So the disk engine integrated Hadoop file system and also worked on support for multiple extension nodes. With BW4, looking at the data store side, you would also have the possibility to not only do the data movement on an object level, but even on the different partitions you may define within a single data store object. Now looking at the consumption side or the SAC integration especially, where with BW4 we made enhancements to the live connection model in BW4 SAC uses to get data from BW4 reporting. Basically, those enhancements now allow us to offer more chart types in case you're using BW4 as a source in your SAC story for things like waterfall charts, time series, variance charts, linked analysis, geospatial charts, because we also made enhancements on the info object side there, conditions, tuple filters. Looking on the openness side for the consumption side as well as the data ingestion side. So the data integration we enhanced in a sense that for the data store objects, we added a new feature that we call write interface or write interface enabled data store objects, basically allowing you to, for those objects you enabled, for which you enabled the write interface, to connect to these objects via the four services that we have at SAP, the data services platform, cloud platform integration, CPI, NetWeaver PI, and the data hub. So these platforms can then connect to this write interface of the data store, allowing you to push data into these via any source you can connect to the data services, to the data hub, to the NetWeaver API and cloud platform integration. It's not meant to be to replace any already existing capabilities that we have, how you would get data into BW, but it's just an additional way how to get data into the system, because of which and because it's only integrated or meant to be integrated with the four services mentioned on that slide, that's not meant to be used by third-party ETL partners, because there you would still get the data into BW, like or via native HANA tables, for instance, putting an OpenOS view on top. So that's still there. And this is a new integration feature that we have for the four services mentioned here. Looking at the consumption side next to that, so in BW4, already available in the classical BW starting from 7.4 on, but even more enhanced in BW4, we have the possibility to generate native HANA calculation views for all the objects you have in BW. So for queries, composite providers, open ODS views, data store objects, and info objects, you have the possibility to let the system generate a calculation view, basically representing the model on the native database side as a calculation view, also including all the required master data, texts, joins, hierarchy information, allowing you on the one hand for a SQL, JDBC, ODBC-based consumption of the data stored in BW. Also on the other hand, for using those calculation views as a basis for any native modeling you would like to apply on the data being available in BW. So if there's, like, for instance, some native data stored in HANA you would like to join with that BW data, you could build your own custom views on top of these generated views, and by that combine the data from the two worlds. What is important also here to mention is that because it is a native HANA calculation view and you access it from the database directly, that also means that there's no BW stack involved, because of which some OLAP or the OLAP engine itself is not involved when accessing the data this way. Also leaving out few functions the OLAP supports if you use or if you query the data via the BW stack, which are not yet supported in those calculation views. One main thing we always get asked why it's not like feature complete, but the main reason is that the OLAP stack is not involved if you access the data this way. Again, looking at the openness side, again, on the direction in case you do some sort of mixed modeling combining BW data and native data. For data store object in BW, we are offering an additional SQL view that's being generated. So that's not to be confused with what we saw on the first slide. Here we are talking about really HANA SQL views, no calculation views, where the main difference especially is that these views do not contain any master data or text joins, because they are mainly intended to support you in your native modeling activities, allowing you things like lookups on the data stored in a data store object or in this data store object. Also, if you are making use of the data tiering optimization functionality where the data is distributed between different tiers, this single view that's being generated ensures that the data is always queried from all the tiers. You don't have to take care about getting the data from the tiers yourself in case you have distributed them on the data source side. Like I said, it also we reduced the number of source system types again from 10 to 4, where we in BW4 then have the HANA source system type, we have the ODP system type, we have a big data source system type, and a file source system type, saying that you lose any of the possibilities you had before in order to connect systems to the BW system. But because we also now have the HANA source system type in there, which makes use of the HANA platform built-in SDA, SDI capabilities, we are, for instance, able to connect any kind of source system you can access through SDA, SDI, also looking at the wide variety of non-SAP sources that you would then be able to connect. We still have the ODP, ODQ there, allowing you for the use of extractors and SLT-based replication. And as you can see, all of these would allow for real-time application, but also for virtualized or federated access. On the integration side, I briefly mentioned it already in the beginning, we were working on integrating the two products, Data Hub and BW4, from a process point of view, allowing you to schedule a task workflow you have created on the Data Hub side from within the process chain you are modeling on the BW4 side. And the other way around is also possible. When you're modeling a task workflow on the Data Hub side, you could include a process chain you have created before on the BW side, in case you have some cross-dependencies between the two, where you do some data wrangling on the data upside. Maybe you are then loading to BW, so you get these cross-scheduling possibilities there. Looking at the data integration in the direction of S4 Cloud, since that is now, or the content was replaced with CDS views in S4 Cloud and S4, in BW, we made it or made it possible to consume these CDS views directly. So you would not have to use the old extractor logic anymore to get data out of the S4 system. You can still do that. So that hasn't been removed. But we also added support for a direct access to the ABAP CDS views available in S4. And with that, we are then also able to consume any custom CDS views as well that you want to consume in BW4. Looking on the modern UI side, we're basically talking about two topics here. One is the modeling tools that we have shipped with the classical BW already, but enhanced even more for BW4. Whereas we are targeting the modeling persona, which would use solely the modeling tools for modeling all the persistency and virtual entities in your BW system. And especially for BW4, what we did is that we worked on getting all the objects we did not yet had integrated into the BW modeling tools so that we integrated them in there as well, especially looking at the transformation and data transposes that we added with 1.0 SP8. But now with 2.0, we also worked off some sort of process chain integration, not in the direction of modeling a process chain, because that is still left to the BW cockpit, the Fiori-based application that we'll see in a second. But basically integrating the process chains into the project explorer that you have in the modeling tools, so that you have like one single tree or overview of all the entities existing in the systems, in your system. Also saying that the process chains would then make use of the info areas. We got rid of the application components for ordering these. We made some enhancements to the already existing data store object editor in the direction of remodeling capabilities. I'll show to you in a second. We added the missing planning functionalities, like planning sequences and all the other objects you would need to or you would build for the BBC integration part, and added things like currency translation types, unit conversion types, and so forth. Looking at the data store objects in more detail, what I was mentioning in the beginning, that we have those field-based data store objects as well, allowing you for a quick way to model your persistency. And over time, once you want to have the info object capabilities or want to make use of those info object capabilities in there as well, what we basically did here is that we try to make it easier to support those existing data store objects where we make use of fields with or replacing those fields with info objects, basically. So what we did is that we added some remodeling capabilities into the data store object editor. So there would be no need anymore to go to the remodeling toolbox, which already offered some support for replacing those fields with info objects. But now we integrated that deeply into the modeling tools, so you don't have to switch again between the tools and have an easier and faster way to replace the fields with info objects if that's required. In BW4, what we also added, basically targeting the administrator persona in the company, is the BW cockpit, which is a Fiori-based, so web-based application, or contains applications, Fiori applications. So what we tried to do here is that we moved all the applications and administrator requires, like process chain modeling and monitoring, managing the data loads in your persistency, in your data store objects, but also other things like external HANA view maintenance, DTO maintenance and overviews, master data maintenance, and hierarchy maintenance. For all of these tasks, we build applications in the BW cockpit. Because it's web-based, it will also allow you now to, for like on the go, for instance, check whether the process chains are running okay. You can, on your mobile, just get a brief overview of if there's any failed data loads. But you don't have the need anymore to always like check it from the old subGUI transaction. So that's, for instance, how it looks like if you would now model a process chain from within the BW cockpit. Also, on the second screenshot in the lower right corner, you see how the monitoring looks like. So even though I said you can do all the stuff from your mobile, I wouldn't really advise you to do the modeling from your mobile. That's quite a hard task to achieve. So that I would probably leave to the laptop. But all the other things, like checking if something's going wrong, that should now be easily doable from any mobile device as well. Because we have replaced the technical content you would previously use for things like data selection statistics and query statistics with ABAP CDS views. So basically, taking away the need for installing the content first in case you want to make use of these statistics. But that also allowed us for creating new applications within the BW cockpit, for getting at least a simple and quick way to work with those statistics. So what we did, that based on these ABAP CDS views we now deliver with the BW4, we also created some visualizations applications so that you can drill down into the statistics and already get an idea of how much data is stored in the system, what is selected, how often. But because it's also ABAP CDS views, you would also be free to build whatever you need yourself, like custom UIs or whatever you already have in your company on top of these as well. On the high performance side, we were basically doing two things, looking at the pushdown capabilities that we have because we are running on HANA only now. So with 2.0, we were working on mainly pushing down conditions to the HANA database, top N, bottom N, less than, greater, and not between. We also moved the analysis authorization modeling to the BW cockpit, since that's also some sort of administration task. So there's a new application in the BW cockpit for modeling these. We are working on the BRF plus variable type. Also integrated the read access logging into the BW4, giving you the possibility to, for selected info objects and info providers, getting an overview when the data of these providers was queried by whom and what time. We were also working on the live connection on the model, giving you those new chart types we already saw on the previous slide, working on the performance of that live connection a little. So basically looking at the consumption or the pushdown capabilities and the consumptions here. Taking a look at the data protection management, how BW4 supports you with being compliant with the general data protection regulations that we have in Europe. So what we did is that in the BW cockpit, we added an application that would, on the one hand, give you an overview of what notifications, what requests do exist in the source system, ECC, S4, for records to be deleted. Also, this application would give you the possibility to, on a record-selected basis, identify those info providers that actually contain these records or have references to the corresponding master data, and then allowing you to either already delete those records if they are not required anymore for legal reasons, for business reasons, or in case they're still required, to anonymize the data. So what we're doing is that we make use of the SAP ILM notifications that are generated in the source system. So for every deletion process that is going on in the source system, these notifications are created, and they are then collected and replicated to the BW system via the BW extractor and stored in a data store object, which again is shipped as technical content you would have to install first to make use of this application. And once you have extracted these notifications to the BW system, you can then navigate to the data protection workbench that is part of the BW cockpit, get an overview of all those notifications that have been replicated, and then selectively start working on the records, identifying the providers, and then, like I said, either deleting the data already or anonymizing them, whatever is required in that case. So in case you are still running a NetWeaver-based BW, a classical BW system, how can you then move on to the BW4 world? So what we did is that we created what we call the conversion tool that is intended to support you in getting from the classical NetWeaver BW to BW4. It comes with a readiness check report you would start off with first, getting an idea of how ready your system already is. Basically, what it does, it takes a look at what entities do exist in your system, which of these entities can be automatically converted to the entities we support in BW4, where maybe some manual effort required because you need to do some remodeling first, adjust certain properties of the entities that cannot be converted automatically. We check what custom code is available in the system. I'm giving you some hints where you would need to take a closer look. So that's basically giving you a good overview of how easy it would be to get to BW4. And having that, then there are basically three ways how you can move on to a BW4 system. There we differentiate between the what we call in-place conversion. We have the remote conversion and the shell conversion. The first ones, the in-place and the remote conversion, those not only transfer the metadata objects to the new world, but they also concern the data that is stored in the persistency, whereas the shell conversion is rather intended for greenfield approaches, even looking at really old source systems, like if you are still running on a 7.0 or whatever is before 7.4 classical BW. But you want to move that to BW4, then the shell conversion is the right thing to do. So the in-place conversion, that is where you would convert the system to BW4 without setting up a second BW4 system and moving data into that, but you would use or would stay within the same system, which on the other hand requires you to really look through the whole system. So there's no way of leaving out certain scenarios. You either have to convert them or you have to delete them if you want to do the in-place conversion, which might be based on the system size, or if you don't want to convert everything that is in the system, can be a hard task to do. The remote conversion, that is then where you would set up a fresh BW system first, like an empty BW system, and then on a scenario selected basis would over time move certain scenarios to the new world. This would then, compared to the in-place conversion, allow you to also leave out certain scenarios you may not require anymore in the BW world. But probably makes it a little harder, for instance, for the risk mitigation, because you have two parallel systems. You have to somehow manage the data loads to the two. You have to, at some point, decide when to switch to the new system, which wouldn't be there for an in-place conversion. And then we have the shell conversion, which is what we also especially see on this side, is there or can be used already from the 7.0 release onwards. So if your source system is still running on any 7.0, 7.01, 7.02 release, you can use the shell conversion there already. The readiness check that is available on all those releases. You have to implement some nodes, though, but you can do the readiness check from 7.0 onwards. The in-place conversion that is only available from 7.5 onwards, but I guess you anyways want to be like very close to the probably newest release in case you want to do an in-place conversion. The remote conversion, you can then, however, start from 7.3 onwards. Looking at the roadmap for the next BW support packages to come, first starting off with the recent innovation, which now in this session is probably more some sort of summary, what we have already, or most of the things what we've seen already on slides. So we basically talked about in the simplicity area, we talked about the right interfaces for data store objects. We talked about the data protection workbench and the DTO implementations or functionalities that we have. What we, for instance, did not get mentioned is that for the DTO functionality with BW4 2.0, now you have the possibility to, on a data store level, select the cold store connection you want to use for that specific data store object. Previously, you would configure one cold store connection for the whole BW system. And the data, whenever you move data to the cold tier, it was always moved to that cold store target. But now, in case you have connected multiple cold store solutions to your BWC system, you can decide on an object level what cold store you want to use. We enabled the data store objects for inventory management and added several external storage destinations here. We already saw that we were working on the data app integration mainly from a process integration side, but we also worked on the metadata repository integration into BW4, especially looking at an improved impact analysis and giving you enhanced capabilities for lineage information, especially looking at the query side. And we also integrated the right interface for the data hub as well for the cloud platform and data services. And we talked about the SQL views for doing that mixed native modeling. On the modern interfaces side, we saw that we added the planning tools to that, or like the missing editors. We moved all of that to the Eclipse world as well. But what we also did is that we worked on some mass modeling capabilities for the data flow, especially beneficial if you have a larger data flow and you want to adjust certain properties for the objects in there. We are supporting the document generation HTML-based now. And we added the DTO maintenance to the BW cockpit. And on the high performance side, as you saw it already, we were working on pushing down conditions like top and bottom end, but also having a ranking. And we worked on the live model for the SAC integration. For 2020, so next year, what we will be working on or started working on already is that looking at the data tiering optimization side, we will allow updates to the cold storage in case that's NLSLQ based. We are working on integrating the native storage extension now coming with the HANA platform as an additional way for the warm tier, supporting you in moving the data to the NSE extension for the warm tier. We are working on some sort of automated temperature management, like some automated data movement management based on rules you can then define in the BW system. For instance, basically allowing you to create rules which can be scheduled on an automated basis and would then regularly check whether partitions can be moved to the next lower or to the cold storage so that you don't have in a manual fashion then check the overview of partitions and move data if required to a lower tier. On the data protection workbench, what we are working on is that we also want to process notifications which are coming from the HANA Cloud Edition. On the openness side, looking now at the SAC direction, we are integrating support for custom shapes files, looking at the geospatial or geo support area or domain. We are working on the pushdown of the current member variable for some performance improvement in that area as well. And we are working on the also, again, metadata integration, but also on the data integration with the data hub side. On the modern interfaces, looking again at the modeling tools, we'll be working mainly on some composite provider enhancements. On the one hand, opening up the join types that you can use within the composite provider. So we want to support all the known join types there as well. We'll also have some feature allowing you to include or to use the same part provider many times within the same composite provider then, which wasn't possible before. Right now, you would have to stack multiple composite providers on top in case you want to use the same part provider within the model. And that also comes with some UI rework, of course. We'll add the hierarchy maintenance as an additional application to the BW cockpit to also be feature complete on that side. So we'll have the master data maintenance. We have that in there already. And we'll add the hierarchy maintenance there as well. And we are also started already working on some integration with Dataverse Cloud, as I mentioned in the beginning, in case you want to go or have some cloud strategy, but you're also already using BW4. We want to make it as smooth as possible for not only transforming or moving the scenarios from the on-premise world to Data Warehouse Cloud, but also looking at the data integration side, talking things like using Data Warehouse Cloud as a data target for BW4, but also using BW4 as a target for Data Warehouse Cloud based on scenarios you might envision there. Plan for the year after and beyond. Again, looking at the simplicity side, for DTO, we already started with those rule-based support, but we want to make that on the other end more automated and also statistic-based, giving you some sort of intelligent suggestions how those rules could be defined or what rules you would actually require for the data movement. We'll also be making use of the Varo runtime in order to connect to even more cold storage destinations, being able to support you to connect to more destinations there. On the modern interfaces side, we are working on applications for some sort of system health monitoring and prediction, especially looking at the statistics that we already have. We want to incorporate them in a way that you have some sort of notifications, can get some predictions when the system would maybe reach the storage limit, for instance. On the openness side, looking at the Data Hub integration that we have, because we already worked on the metadata integration, like the BW metadata repository, integrating that into metadata catalog. We'll be further working on the impact analysis and following that on some more seamless, at least, data exchange. Only looking at BW, we'll have some open up modernization in there. Basically talking about making use of the Varo runtime as an underlying feature for open up as well. And because of that, then also allowing you to push data to any kind of source you can connect to via the Varo runtime. So that would then also include some UI modernization in there. And also looking at the Data Warehouse Cloud side again, so we'll start off with some sort of metadata integration. But following that, we'll be starting to work on some sort of process integration, somewhat the same what we also did for the Data Hub already, integrating the processing or scheduling capabilities like the process chain in BW with the scheduling capabilities that we'll have in Data Warehouse Cloud, so that you have some cross scheduling capabilities in there as well. And we'll be working on a tight integration for the metadata and data exchange. One last slide I have for you in case you actually have a cloud strategy or you have some plans to, within the next years, move from your on-premise BW to the Data Warehouse Cloud solution. This again just highlights the two scenarios that we envision for the combination of the on-premise BW and the Data Warehouse Cloud product. So the first one is, or what is mentioned here as a first highlight, is the hybrid or mixed scenario that we'll be also working on by the integration I was mentioned earlier, where we think about BW as like the still on-premise and very tightly governed BW system containing all the important scenarios, all the important data. But on the other hand, you want to get some more freedom or want to give your LOBs, for instance, more freedom in terms of how they can use those scenarios already existing in the on-premise BW, giving them more freedom in how they can integrate custom data not yet stored in the BW system, allowing them to enhance their reporting scenarios in a more easy manner. So that's how we envision the two products to play together. You would still use BW as like the real tightly governed basis, but still use, or in addition, use Data Warehouse Cloud to have some more freedom in how those scenarios could be enhanced, what data you can add to the governed data in BW. The second scenario then would be, in case you want to completely over time move to the cloud solution, then BW4 would be the optimal starting point, allowing for a smooth transition because we're working on the tight integration there. So that you would start from BW and over time select all those scenarios you want to move to Data Warehouse Cloud, because you can use it as a source for Data Warehouse Cloud and the other way around, so that we basically are all set with BW4 for that transition to the cloud, if that's your plan for the future, basically. And that, with that, I'd like to close it all up. Thanks a lot for attending, and have safe travels home. Thanks.